Welcome back. You're still watching Checkpoint here with Million Commission. And tonight I'm speaking to Ms. Elizabeth Mushabe here at the UN Women. We are discussing HIV/AIDS, sexual and gender-based violence. We are looking at COVID-19. We are looking at all things gender-based violence and how we can mitigate the issues and the challenges that come with all that. Now, before we took a break, she highlighted women and your money. Empowerment. The UN Women is trying to empower women. If you don't want to go to school, it's okay, but can you make some money for yourself? I like that. Now, during the 14th annual Joint AIDS Review, UN Women say that while COVID-19 presents a twin challenge to HIV, therein lies a promising opportunity to showcase collective resilience and address extreme and intersecting vulnerabilities. But research has shown that when women work, economies grow, there's increasing economic diversification, equality, and development. COVID-19 affected women and their poverty situation. Because we noticed that when we're talking poverty, women are, you know, the leading poverty-stricken people. Sadly, what can be done to mitigate the effects of COVID-19 to women?
A lot can be done. A lot has already started to happen. The first thing we need to consider is to know that times change. COVID-19 is an emergency. It did not give notice to nobody. While women were affected, children were affected, men were affected, communities were affected. And we will not be shy to say women were affected in diverse ways. Because if you look at what we see in our homesteads, in our households, this is a time when work, for example, for women as caregivers, as women as we know them, as heads of households, actually increased. You would have maybe 2 hours of work at home in the morning and 2 hours of work at home in the evening when you return. But this time you had 24 hours, 7 days a week of work. So clearly there was a spike in the kind of responsibility that women had. We also saw women face a lot of abuses. They were sexually abused, they were physically abused, they were mentally disturbed, and with no assistance. So what can we do for these women, or what has been done for these women? We have seen a lot of the Build Back Better programs attend to these adverse effects that different people have had to live with or put up with. We've had situations where rapid assessments or quick studies do show the direct impact that COVID-19 has had. And all of them almost point to one thing: loss of livelihoods. So what we have done as UN Women and what we are advocating for through our civil society movements, through our women human rights defenders groups that we support and collaborate with, is to say that all COVID-19 recovery programs must, as a matter of priority, consider the needs of women and girls. And there is evidence to use to see if you are in education, what should you prioritize for women and girls? If you're in infrastructure, what should you prioritize? If you're in business, what should we prioritize? And this speaks a lot to the cost of the cost of the gender gap. If you don't invest in women and girls and their needs that we see apparent and where data and evidence points us, then there is something we're going to lose. And that, when put in monetary terms, of course, has implications in the longer term for development and for our economy. The second thing we are saying that should happen is, let's prepare better for such disasters and epidemics. I think what COVID-19 did was to expose our disaster preparedness inefficiencies. We need to be able to prevent adversity in the face of disaster. Adversity for women, for children, for men, but for women especially, because many times And this is not something UN Women has scripted. It is global. It's all over and every sector you'll go to. In the face of war, in the face of an epidemic, in the face of disaster, maybe flood, maybe any other climate change effect, women and children suffer more. So since we know this, what stops us from preventing better and making sure we have interventions clearly cut to secure women and to secure children? That is another thing we need to do. And we are advocating seriously with the relevant government departments. The third thing we are trying to do is to request for better attention to gender data, what we call statistics that show the differences in effect to men, women, girls, and boys. So that as we speak, we are not emotional. We are not speaking from we like men or we don't like men. We are speaking from facts, what pertains. Now, this gender data helps you to show then where you should concentrate your effort in situations where you have less resources and what will be the yield when you concentrate your effort there. Those are the three things we are pushing for right now as we also understand the terrain and support government to be able to plan better and to make sure that all the post-COVID recovery programs and initiatives do consider the vulnerable and populations that were rendered helpless and hopeless by COVID-19.
Do you think the government is in position to really reach out to everybody, especially the women and girls?
Yes, of course. Governments are governments. Me and you are government. We are a United Nations agency. And I will say that the United Nations is an intergovernmental body. So there is no way we will sit here and say governments can. We have the can't. We have the responsibility to make sure that governments can reach everybody. You have the responsibility as media to make sure that you point to where the gaps are and invite government and their partners to go there. So I think with that kind of collective effort, governments can. Yes.
Now, some lawyers have suggested that stay-at-home mothers should be paid. I like the smile on your face. That implies that we are speaking the same language. Should be paid as compensation for doing family chores. Now, I quote, they said, they actually revealed that unless governments consider unpaid care work as a serious issue, we shall not achieve our sustainable development goals, especially SDG 5, which says enhancing gender equality among women and men. Now, we're going to say if we don't value the work of women, it's very hard to achieve the correct gross domestic product as a country. UN Women spearheading gender equality and empowerment. What is your take on this, Elizabeth?
It's an interesting debate going on out there. And as we all know it, like we said, that women should have some kamani.
Yeah.
I want to use your
words.
Yes,
some kamani.
Women, yes, should have some kamani of their own. And I think the lawyer's recommendation and perspectives is informed by what is pertaining around us. It is, I'm not a lawyer, I'll not speak for them, but I know that by the time they make such a recommendation, they must have done their research, they must have studied their cases that they deal with every day, and they realize that the problem stems from women having no money, doing so much and not being recognized or acknowledged. And so they are saying, okay, if I'm going to do all this, please pay up. But look, it comes with its effects. I will not say no to their recommendation because I'm not there. I will fully acknowledge their recommendation, but caution that we must apply it in context. First, understand your environment, because you will have backlash in situations where the person you're asking to pay you will say, I can afford two or three actually. Can I pay you up? And can we be what I want you to be? They might even start to say, look, since you want me to pay, then you have to sweep from here to there. You have to cook so much. You have to do all these things. You don't want to get there. So please, let's receive that recommendation, digest it, put it into our own context, and actually apply it.
We are assuming the stay-home mothers have husbands who are working. And so maybe they could chip in allowance, a monthly allowance, not necessarily saying, okay, so you do so much, can we quantify it? Why not just appreciate the woman?
I wish I could agree with you. It's not only appreciating a woman, but when I said context, I meant it. Look at Uganda. What are the employment rates? How many husbands are actually employed? He's probably getting into relationship with you so that you can put your heads together and do something. Now, if I'm going to pay you, it's going to be part of our company resources that we were trying, or enterprise resources we were trying to put up. Do I then still look at you as a partner? Do you see how you're stepping the woman down? We were at a level where we were partners in this enterprise. Now you want me to pay you, meaning you have to step a little bit down, allow me to take certain decisions on your behalf, and then determine the wage to pay you. So let's receive it again. Let's digest it in our own context, what is possible. But the underlying message that the lawyers are sending is, please and please acknowledge domestic care work that women do. Where possible, begin to redistribute it to the members of the family, of the household, so that we can all take on what we can. Do not load it on one person. I think that is the overriding message, that domestic work is work and should start to be acknowledged.
Absolutely. I like that. Now, away from women and desiring to be paid while you're at home, female persons living with disabilities are one of the many categories, I beg your pardon, vulnerable, and such has been worsened where violence exists in a home. UN Women, we need to put into account that making gender equality central to national development planning and budgeting is one of UN Women program areas with female persons with disabilities. How do we do this?
Yes, we have, I think, had our go on that. And working with the Ministry of Gender, you know, we have an equal opportunities policy that is due for update, given what we see emerging and the increase in the numbers. We have agreed with the ministry, from their own request, to do a quick or a follow-on survey from the last one on functional abilities that was done by UBOS to establish what categories of disability do we have, what needs stay outstanding, and how can we resource interventions and programs that meet their needs. For me, the National Development Plan 3 is very strategic, and it's a great opportunity for all of us who are interested in women or persons with disability. It presents two very lovely programs I like. One of them is on community mobilization and mindset change. As communities, how do we perceive disability? How do we support people that are differently abled to thrive and to contribute to development, to enjoy their health and be well, to do what they can do better? There is another opportunity in there that looks at human capital development. Now, this human capital development program presents a platform where all of us who can and are interested can come in, one, to prevent disability, because some of these disabilities are not born, to facilitate persons with disability, like lift them up from that step and sense of feeling, I mean, for me, I was cast, I'm a cast to the family, I am unlucky, and but change their attitude and rehabilitate and show them that, look, if you can actually use what you have, it simply shows that you're differently able from the other. It also gives us an opportunity to create special interventions for those that need special attention. You, for example, will have a lot of children now that are putting on aspects. Me and you probably did it, we loved it, we enjoyed it, but there is a point at which, if you recall, at least I do, where everyone was telling me, look at you putting on side mirrors. Because I have never had small spectacles. They have to be big for the disability that I have. But I came also later to learn that there are those that admire them and they will buy the black shades. So you can no longer tease me now. Can you help your boy and girl that is getting crippled maybe by polio? That look, your other part is fine. You can still read and write. Write with your left arm if this one is not holding well, and do even better than those that are using their right hand. It's about mindset change. It's about rehabilitation. It's about increasing opportunities, and it's about understanding their abilities and exploiting and supporting them to live their full potential. So as UN Women, we are getting into that space, and it's a priority population for us, because when you talk of gender equality and equity, equity speaks to the functional abilities of individuals, and it's a space you will see us and meet us more often after now than before. I can say that our last 10 years have not been so focused on that team or that group seriously, but we are beginning to realize that people are differently abled, both men and women, boys and girls. And it's something we are picking up and taking up as part of our Leave No One Behind programming. And we will be sharing better experiences probably after now and breakthroughs, if at all. We will not work on this alone. We intend to keep the Ministry of Gender close because they are the ministry mandated. And with their guidance, we think that over the next 5 years of our strategic program in Uganda, we'll have something more concrete and more clearer that we will focus on in terms of persons and women specifically living with disabilities. Mm.
Now, let me draw you to the recent World AIDS Day. President Museveni said he urges local leaders to guide communities to dialogue and reflect on community-owned solutions and pay particular attention to eliminating poverty, which we have, you know, extensively talked about, and creating wealth, because these are key underlying factors for, one, HIV acquisition and sexual and gender-based violence. How can you, who is watching, guarantee the future of our children and grandchildren to grow up in post-COVID? One, take into account the Gender Action Plan. Three, equal opportunities policy that you've talked about.
The president was very clear. There's one word he said, if you recall, enduro.
Yes.
And that enduro can be noise, that enduro can be alarm, that enduro can be shout out, that enduro can be voice it out. And I think the only way we are going to guarantee the future of our children is to voice out what needs to happen now. Don't keep it to yourself. I have told you that as UN Women, we are not an education program, but we are saying keep girls in school. That's very loud. A girl is a girl, whether she's a mother or five, as long as she's before 19 years old, she's a girl. Keep them in school. Increase those learning opportunities. Create spaces where they can overcome that has befallen them. Because look at a situation where your children, you have a boy and a girl, they are your own. They conceive, the girl conceives. Who has impregnated her? It's your son.
Yeah, there was that story.
It's not one, it's not two. Many of those stories are not scripted.
Yes.
They are several out there. You didn't want this. You were lucky before they would be in school, in the boarding dormitory for boys, boarding dormitory for girls. They come home for a few weeks, you can observe. Here you had 2 years. And they were also struggling.
Yes.
And what they were doing, they probably didn't know. And they did what they did. The boy is astute. He's here. The girl is expecting. So very soon, you will have a grandchild, your own grandchild. I don't know how to call that one.
I know.
But it's a grandchild. Okay? Now, if you want to guarantee the future of those three, you must say it out. You must drum it up. You must do that nduru and tell parents around you and say, when this boy and girl are closed in a room, it doesn't matter, they are brother and sister. Things will happen. Speak to them. Tell them what mom and dad are doing. They have planned it. You are not yet ready to do this. Speak up. That's one way of guaranteeing the future of our children. Number two, let's be honest with our interventions and how we invest the little resources we have. You cannot get all the equipment, the money, the skills, the time even to do everything you want to do. But there are priorities that you must attend to. So in setting our priorities, let's be honest. Let's not misallocate and misappropriate resources meant for what we think is priority into other things. Let's not be selfish. And by doing that, we must engage them, the young ones. Because you don't know what is in their heads. You will not be honest by guessing. So meaningful engagement and participation of these young people is very, very important. You then know what their potential is in terms of risk to certain things, but also their potential is in terms of overcoming the challenges that face them. Some of them need daily assistance. Some of them are good to go. They are already ready to go. So all you need to do is to show them that this is done like this. It was done like that. It didn't work out. It was done like that. It worked out. Please blend with what you know and what you feel and think, and let me know how we can help each other. That engagement, that dialogue, that close attention and honest attention has to be sustained.
I like that you highlight engagement, that continuous engagement, but it has been taken over by social media, by internet, world over. Children, young adults, adolescents are all over social media. And we might not have control over that because the world is moving really fast via technology. How do we continue engaging the adolescents, especially because they are at risk, and young adults in that regard? Because social media, the internet exposes them. Now we have, it's a new trend. It has been going on elsewhere in the world, but Africa is also catching up on online studying. And it also exposes these children to a lot other issues. How do we continuously engage them? I don't want to use control because we cannot control. How do we do that? How do we come around the internet age?
Yeah, two things need to happen because indeed it's a dual track. That exposure to social media and internet has also come with harassment, with learning new things because you see them. And I was reading some papers by a professor with the Solidarity Center who was estimating the cost of the economic cost of gender-based violence, and especially cyber gender-based violence. She says that it's high and countries will not afford going forward unless we invest in prevention. Her concern was that a lot of the investment is needed to avert the health effects, health in terms of physical health, mental health, and general well-being. And so I think what we need to run to is prevent that from occurring. How are we going to prevent it? I think the world showed us in one of the global meetings we had, the Generation Equality Forum, that it's possible to engage these social media proprietors and be able to put in controls for what we watch, what we post, and what platforms we access. I am imagining 5-10 years after today, when that happens, we will be in a better position. But before that happens, could we, as people who use social media, stop posting, for example, our nudes? Because when I post, when you post, when he posts, and anyone watching posts, our children will get to this. They don't know why you were posting it, but they will say, oh, so even if I am growing a bigger hip, I can also put there and people will see. And she will also put her own, because she will want to see how does she look like. Does she also look like that he saw? Now, that's the beginning of trouble. Can we regulate what we post? Because you are the one that has access to social media. The only chance he, she has to social media is when you have subscribed to the internet at home or given him or her some MBs. If you don't give them, they won't get. Number two, there are controls on most of our gadgets that we use at home. I don't want to speak to those that don't have access. Those that have access, there are controls. If it is TV, there are controls. Please use this. If it is internet and you subscribe for the whole house, there are controls. There is what you tell the service provider to allow and disallow. Pick up those. And so the third point that takes me to is to increase awareness on how to use social media. We are assuming everyone knows how to use social media. No, it's not true. And when we blame the commission, the Communications Commission, for tracking and trailing our phones and our internet work, I think we need to work with them rather to make sure that we regulate what flows. They need not get into our privacy because it's a rights issue. They rather regulate what gets posted and what stays on, because you can disable it. You can. There are many ways of disabling it. So instead of them going into our private world, let them get into their control rooms, regulate what gets posted and what is viewed by the public. That way we might reduce. But it's a complex space, I must say, and it needs a lot of thought and interrogation to understand what can actually happen. Finally, the other day as UN Women, we had a very exciting session with women human rights defenders who were launching some guidance on how women and girls can avoid cyber harassment. Yes. And we have a lot of hope in that movement. We hope it will increase the potential of harassment on social media among our women communities and girls, and be able also to give them tips on how to avoid this should it happen, because it is mentally disturbing, it is derailing, it erodes their confidence and esteem when they are attacked on social media. So those are some of the little steps we are taking to make sure we assist our communities of women and girls to avoid harassment, cyber harassment as we call it. But I think it's a complex place.
It is still a complex place, but I think we are making strides in the right direction. Allow my curiosity. You mentioned economic effects of GBV and cyber as well. Do you mind sharing some more about that? How are we doing as a country?
As a country, I will not say we are doing much, because we don't even have any study that is estimating the economic cost of gender-based violence. But it is something we can have. What I was alluding to is something that was done by one Professor Robin, who is a feminist lawyer, who is a GBV activist, who is a researcher, but is also a co-director for equality and inclusion at the Solidarity Center, and who was quoted to have said that safe work and safe working conditions are not actually impossible. They are possible if we address gender-based violence. And she even went ahead to work with other colleagues to estimate the cost of what this is likely to be for the whole world. So the figures I could probably share with you are for the world, not Uganda. Uganda has not done such a study that I'm aware of yet. But if it came through, it would be very interesting because it would be a great advocacy piece now for us to understand what are we missing when we don't pay attention to gender-based violence.
That's right.
Yes.
Okay. Now as we wind up, we see that COVID-19 disruption affected a critical enabler for girls in school. Some advocates of women empowerment say doesn't matter. What level of education or economic background a woman or a girl has, a community with sexual and gender-based violence is discriminatory. What do you have to say about that?
I fully agree. Because discrimination is discrimination. You're in school, you're not in school, it's discrimination. And we also need to know that gender-based violence is a violation of rights. These are human rights. These are people that deserve better. So when you sexually assault, when you abuse, when you emotionally hurt, when you deprive or exclude women and girls, you're violating their rights. So be it in school, be it out of school, at home, anywhere, I agree that it is a violation of rights. And my take on that is not going to be an individual issue or a single agency matter. It's more of a collective. We want to see our leaders, because they take these podiums, they have these boardrooms, they have chance to speak to television audiences like we are doing now, to call on everyone to begin to identify the manifests of violence. How does violence manifest in our communities? I have watched, sadly, on WhatsApp, we call it social media, I know generally, women tying up their children and beating them.
Yeah.
That you're punishing him or her. I have witnessed one of the incidences, which was the most unimaginable, where a young boy was stripped naked, put in red ants, tied on a tree, and made to stand in red ants. So they ate him anywhere and everywhere and all over, including the ears. Young boy was tied up. So the only thing he did was keep stepping so that they can fall off. You know red ants, they won't fall off easily.
They won't.
So, and the mother was watching. And the people that were filming, I was thinking, the person who is filming, where is your heart? And why are you filming this young boy in agony? Why would you do that? So I think as leaders, as communities, we need to say no to some of these direct manifests of violence. So, because if you film it and want it to run viral on social media, where is your heart? Are you against it? Are you for it? Are you telling other children that if you do it, the same thing, I'll do this to you? I mean, there is a problem. And I think it's us, it's the leaders that need to speak and say no to some of these things.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Elizabeth Mushabe. It's been a wonderful, wonderful conversation we've had. Unless you have your part.
My parting shot is really to thank Urban TV. And for knowing that you've joined the media fraternity that is interested in these subjects, we hope to see you many more times. I think I was watching my colleague from UNAIDS speak on Urban TV about HIV, and now that you bring in also the other intersections that we see with HIV, we think it's promising. For the media to come out and spend time and dedicate your airspace to some of these social concerns for us is a big score. And yes, thank you, and thank you again.
Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you very much, Ms. Elizabeth. Thank you for watching Checkpoint tonight. My name is Lynn. We'll catch you another time.